going on Nativity.
Good evening, everybody. I'm happy that you could join us for this live streaming presentation. Please join me as we begin with a prayer. And I'm going to appeal to one of my favorite prayers from Thomas Merton. And it's a prayer for a time of uncertainty, which certainly we are in. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end, nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire, and I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen. Well, again, welcome. I'm glad you could join us. And just want to give a little bit of background to what we're doing tonight. First and foremost, when I do presentations, and these presentations for the next several weeks should last 15 or 20 minutes, I always prepare too much. So there's a chance I may go a little longer this evening, but I'm going to try to keep it to 15 and 20 minutes. These talks came about through our faith formation and social media departments coming together and saying, what can we do to help us be better Catholics, better Christians? And you may recall this past year we came together with the idea that we would have this theme for the year, find your why. Why give? Why serve? Why pray? And in the beginning of the year, we focused on our giving, on our stewardship. Throughout the season of Lent, we focused on why serve. And then finally, in the Easter season, we had decided to focus on why pray, and in particular, to focus on the celebration of the Mass and how we as Catholics do that together. We were going to use, during the Easter season, the homily time at all of our Masses here at Nativity to focus on different parts of the Mass and break them open so that we could have a better understanding of the Mass that we partake in. And as you know, our plan was changed. We're no longer gathering on Sundays. We're looking forward to that time when we could come together again. But until then, we're trying to figure out, well, how can we share this message of why pray? And in particular, why pray the Mass? And we thought we would do this series. So for the next several weeks on Wednesday evening, starting at 7 o'clock, again, for about 15 or 20 minutes, through May 27th, we're going to have a series on the Mass, breaking down the different parts of Mass, and have different staff members offer those presentations to you. So don't worry, you don't have to listen to me every week. I will kind of bring up the rear and take care of the last session itself, but in between, various members of our staff will offer their perspective on different parts of the Mass and how we worship. So tonight I want to do an overview and an introduction. As a people, as human beings, we need to get together. Now, as much as you might enjoy your alone time or quiet time, and I do, I am recharged by quiet time, we are all still social, very social beings. And with what's happened with the pandemic, I just want you to think for a minute about something that's happened in Italy and something that happens in the United States. There was a nightly practice in Italy. I think it still continues. And people who had been sheltered or confined to their homes in Italy, early in the evening came out on their balconies and started to sing and play instruments. And many times they did that, as time went on, in appreciation to those medical professionals who are caring for the sick and for the dying. In the United States, something similar was happening. I saw a number of videos and news clips about neighborhoods where people were coming out of their homes in their neighborhood, singing or playing particular songs, and enjoying that bit of time while social distancing the whole time, enjoying that time together. The reason that we do that in the United States, in Italy, all over the world, is because we were created by God to be social beings, to share with one another. At the Mass, there are two realities that happen when we gather together on Sunday or if you come to daily Mass. And the first is we come together to give thanks in the same way that those folks from Italy were thanking the medical professionals for what they were doing, how they were caring and generously and sacrificially caring for others. They gathered to sing a song to offer thanks. And that's the first thing that we do at Mass. In fact, you've heard me say this before, the word Eucharist means thanksgiving, literally giving thanks. Eucharist is an action word, and it means the process of giving thanks. It demands something from us. And the second purpose for us gathering together like we do at Mass is it reflects our need and how God created us to be social. Oftentimes I hear from others, maybe you've said that yourself, I don't need to go to church. I could just pray from my heart in the quiet of my room. Now, private prayer is an important and very, very good thing. But again, because there is a public nature to us, a social nature to us, then it's important that we celebrate who and what we are, especially as Catholics, in a public forum. The example of what's happening in Italy, in the United States, and all over the world is an example of those two things, giving thanks and also gathering as a people together. And that's what we do at Mass. There's another aspect I'd like us to focus on as well, and that is that we are all about ritual and repeating ritual. I remember doing some graduate work in a Catholic university, and while I was doing that, being invited to participate in my first football game on that campus. And it was an incredible thing, especially since I was studying liturgy and seeing what was happening in preparation and during this football game. On Saturdays, when we gather for something like that, many people wear similar clothes or the same clothes. We wear many times the same colors, school colors. I remember hearing, as we were anticipating going to the stadium, the band coming, the band marching, and everyone falling in behind the band that was playing. And they walked to the stadium, they marched to the stadium, and we were in lockstep with them behind that. When we went into the game, as if you're a fan of football, you know the beauty of the game is that it doesn't change. It's the same. We know the rules. We know how long it's going to be. We know how many quarters there are. We know how many players are on the field. We know when someone gets a penalty, what that is for. At a game, we eat the same food. We drink the same drinks. When we win, we congratulate each other. When we lose, we console each other. There's a struggle usually represented at those games. It's kind of us versus them, good versus bad. At the end of the game, and at this Catholic university, they do this at the end of every game. They sing the alma mater. They sing the same song. They go to the same area in the stadium to sing it. Everyone does that together. They lock arms. They sway back and forth. My friends who don't go to church and who say we're not ritual people are the same kind of people that obsessively involve themselves in the ritual of sport. The reason they do that is because that's what we are made for. We are made for each other. We thrive with ritual. We're all about ritual and repeating ritual. And if you don't think we need ritual, just ask yourself this. What one of you would want to celebrate a birthday by yourself? I don't want to do that. I want to celebrate that with other people. What one of you would want to celebrate a birthday without birthday cake, without candles lit on the cake, without making a wish and blowing the candles, without presents? That is ritual. We even sing the same song, Happy Birthday. Imagine you celebrating your birthday and all of your friends are standing around and they recite Happy Birthday to you. You'd be like, no, I want you to sing to me. We are made for ritual. Ritual is ingrained in our being. It's how God created us to be. Ritual is usually a safe, regular, defined way to express something happening on a deeper level. When we celebrate someone's birthday, we're not just celebrating, oh, chronologically, they reached 50 years. We celebrate the person. We celebrate who they are, what they mean to us. There's a deeper thing going on there. This ritual that we experience is an expression of our love and our relationship. And rituals are as old as humankind. So we are people made for ritual. We are people made to give thanks. We are people made to be with one another. And the church, the Catholic Church, beautifully, wonderfully captures that reality. And that's what we celebrate at each and every Mass. That's why every time when I come to preside at Mass, it's new and it's exciting for me. I enjoy doing that. People will say, oh, looks like you enjoy celebrating Mass. And I'm like, I do. It's new. It's exciting. And it kind of touches on something deeper. Giving thanks, gathering together, building one another up, and offering to God thanks and blessings for all that we've been given. So let me share with you a couple of terms. We often refer to Sunday, what we do, as Mass, or a weekday Mass. The word has its roots in the Latin language, and it means simply being sent. When we say at the end of Mass, the Mass is ended, basically we're saying, go out into the world. And in fact, that will be, when we wrap all this up together, that will be one of the things I'll focus on in the last session. We participate in Mass in order to be formed into the person of Jesus Christ. And as we are formed into the person of Jesus Christ, we must live like him. We are sent into the world, Misa, sent out, go out. We are sent into the world to be Christ for the world. We also use another term, and that is liturgy. That has its roots in the Greek language. Liturgy means the work of the people. I always love that expression because it reminds us Mass isn't just the work of a priest or a deacon or the ministers in the sanctuary. It's our work, and we exercise our part by singing, by responding, by giving our attention, by opening our hearts, by asking the Lord to convert us and change us. The liturgy is our work. And it takes work to be more like Christ. In our Catholic tradition and in many other traditions, there are two great liturgies, the liturgy of the Eucharist, which we know as Mass, what we do on Sunday and during the week, and then the liturgy of the hours, where we at specific times pray, where we open our hearts to the presence and the goodness of our God. And the Liturgy of the Hours, and if you prayed with us during the Triduum on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday, you prayed part of the Liturgy of the Hours, morning prayer. We specifically pray in the morning to dedicate ourselves to the Lord. We pray in the evening to thank God for our day, to ask for forgiveness for the sins that we've committed. And the Church tells us that those hours are the hinges on which the door of our day hangs. And it's the way that we enter into a relationship with Christ and exit out into the world to be Christ for others. So the two great liturgies, the Mass and Liturgy of the Hours. Those two liturgies are the way we ritualize and express our thanks as a body of believers. So where does our structure of the Mass come from? I had a neighbor when I was in high school who was of a different faith tradition. He would say, "Are you Catholics? You know, you have all these man-made rituals." And I never then had a good response to him about that. I was like, "Oh, well, I guess we do." And as I explored my faith even more, I came to realize that this wasn't, Mass isn't something created by us. It was something given to us by God. One of the first things that I have people appeal to is, when you think of Mass, go first to Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. The story of the road to Emmaus. And in fact, if you are participating in our live streaming of daily Mass, you know that we're in the middle of that Gospel right now. You'll hear the end of it tomorrow. So a very brief retelling of that story. Disciples of Christ witness the death of Jesus. They're returning back home. They're crestfallen. They encounter Christ. They don't recognize him. So this person, Christ, explains to them and opens up to them the meaning of Scripture, starting with the very beginnings of the Old Testament, and then talks about the mystery of the death of Christ and how it was told that he would rise from the dead. Their hearts were burning within them, and Jesus acts as if he's going to go on, and they ask him to stay. And they sit down at a table, and Jesus breaks bread, and they realize in the breaking of the bread that Jesus is there. That is, at its core, the structure of our Mass, gathering together, bringing our hopes and disappointments to the Lord feeding us with his word, nourishing us with his word, and then doing what Christ did at the Last Supper, taking bread, blessing it, breaking it, taking a cup, blessing it, being reminded it's the covenant, the new covenant of Jesus Christ. New life won for us on the cross and through his resurrection. That's where Mass comes from. What the early Christian community started doing right after the resurrection of Jesus was to gather like that. The early Christians, when they came together, they came together to remember, and they would use that word, and we use it in our liturgy today, remember. They use the word remember. They remember the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And for Jews and for Christians, for us today, remembering isn't just a means of having a memory. But when we remember liturgically, remember as Christians and Catholics, the reality is alive. We come shoulder to shoulder with the reality. And at every Mass, we are shoulder to shoulder with Jesus, who lived, who suffered, who died, who rose again. He is really here among us. The Scriptures reflect that too. What does Jesus say? Where two or more are gathered, there he is among them. So how is Christ present to us at the liturgy? First of all, we think, if we're asked, where is Jesus at Mass, we'll say the Eucharist, of course. Jesus is present to us sacramentally in the Eucharist, the bread of life, the cup of salvation. Jesus truly, really comes to us. Jesus is present to us in his word. I'm always fond of saying that the Word, the Scriptures, aren't just stories about God or about Christ. They are God speaking to us, providing for us a specific word that is meant specifically for us. Jesus is present in the assembly, and that's maybe one of the hardest things to accept. The people standing next to us and in front and behind, we are all Christ when we gather together. Hopefully we remember that in how we treat one another. And then Christ is present in the presider. In this way, the church tells us when the priest presides, it's really Christ presiding. If a priest or deacon baptizes, it's Christ doing the baptism. If a priest is praying over the bread and wine, it's really Christ doing the action. So those are the four ways that God is truly, really present to us at the Mass. And finally, I'm going to end with just a very brief overview of the introductory parts of the Mass. There are two essential parts to the introductory section of the Mass. The first is, you may not think so initially, but the first is the song that we sing. It's what unites us and gathers us together. People coming from disparate parts of our city, our county, our community, coming together united in this song in Christ. The second part is the opening prayer, called a collect. Literally, it collects us together. Those are the two main parts of the introductory rites. There are other minor parts, the rite of penitence, where we acknowledge our sin, we ask God to forgive us, to reconcile us before we worship, the Gloria, the Christmas hymn of praise, which never was originally a part of the Mass, it was adopted later on, and which we omit. We omit in Advent, in anticipation of singing it in a big way at Christmas, and we omit it as we just did during the season of Lent, waiting for that day, that big day, Easter, to recite or sing the Gloria as well. So one of the reasons we're going through this little series on praying, and in particular how we pray the Mass, is so that we know more about it. And if we know more about the Mass, it will enable us to engage more fully in it. So I'm going to wind down now, and I'm going to ask you to do some homework in preparation for next week. And I'd like you to take your scriptures, and sometime this week, I'd like you to just read that Road to Emmaus event. It's Luke 24, verses 13 through 35. Read that and look at that and ask yourself, how does this really reflect what we do each and every Sunday? I think you'll be amazed at almost the exact parallel. And the very fact that Christ is at the center of that story in the same way that Christ is at the center of what we do at Mass. The other thing I'd like you to do, and I think we're going to put it up for you and the link for you, and that is to read over or read sections of Bishop Lynch's pastoral letter, which he issued several years ago. It's called Living Eucharist, Gathered, Nourished, and Sent. And there's a wonderful introduction, and the Mass is broken down into different parts, and it's not lengthy at all. It really, really is a good and an easy read. This will help you to prepare for each of the sections that we're going to cover over the next few weeks. So I'm hoping you'll tune in again next Wednesday at 7 o'clock, where our speaker, I think, will be Dr. Carlos, and we're going to talk about music and why music is such an important part of the liturgy and how it fits in together. So again, grateful that you're with us, and would like to conclude with a blessing. This blessing comes from our Easter Masses. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God bless you through the Easter solemnities, and in his compassion defend you from every assault of sin. And may he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only begotten Son endow you with the prize of immortality. Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you.